Department of Transportation, where the TLDR of my job is that I analyze crash data to see where the most dangerous streets are and how we can fix them. No shortage of work there. But my academic background is in city planning, which is where I learned about GIS and how to make maps. And I just became really interested in it over time. Just a quick overview. I want to keep it as broad as possible without getting too much into the weeds since this is an intro. So I'm going to talk about some basic mapping terms and data types, the importance of coordinate systems and projections, the visual map elements you need when you're making a map, and we'll finish with some really ugly maps. So one of the other reasons, other than my grad school education, like one of the reasons I like maps is because my family is from a country that is frequently not featured on a lot of maps. My family is from Sri Lanka, so you can see Sri Lanka's at the bottom and so frequently left off. Where is that? What is that? I've never heard of that. Is that part of India? So I've liked maps even before I started grad school. Okay, so I added this yesterday to the presentation, because I'm sure the person and you know, the governor said she's not a data scientist, she's someone that's got a degree in journalism, communication, and geography. And geography and geospatial analysis is a form of data science. It's not just, it's not like we're not in the 1700s hand drawing maps with a quill just to see where places are on the earth. We're analyzing, you know, the spatial relationships between various types of data. So geography, a big part of geography is spatial analysis, which is a form of data science. Okay, so some basic mapping terminology that you may or may not have heard. Probably the most common one is GIS, which stands for Geographic Information System. And a GIS is your one-stop shop for gathering, managing, and analyzing data. So you're analyzing the spatial location, and you're organizing this information into visualizations using maps and 3D scenes. And so you use GIS to manage your data, you create databases, you visualize it, and you create all these different maps using GIS. Cartography is just the science or practice of drawing maps, so it's more about the design element. And you will probably also hear the term shapefile a lot. And that's the vector data format for GIS software and making maps. A shapefile represents points, polygons, or lines, and it contains the geographic information about an element, as well as a backend attribute information. And I'll talk a little bit more about attribute information later. And as GIS becomes more open source, we're not restricted to using shapefiles anymore. There are other formats like GeoPackage, KML, and I'm sure there'll be more as it becomes more open source. Okay, so there's two main kinds of data. There's vector data and there's raster data. So as I said in the previous slide, vector data consists of points, lines, and polygons, and each feature type needs to be stored separately. So you'll have a point file, a polygon file, or a line file, but you won't have, say, you know, a point file of cities and a line file of streets. Those can't be in the same file. And then there's another kind of data called raster data, which I personally don't use very much, but I know a lot of my friends in environmental science do. So there are certain kinds of data that can't be stored in points, lines, or polygons. So it's a little hard for me to explain, but if you notice the images, you can use information gathered from LiDAR, radar data, and other remote sensing tools to get imagery. And that imagery is not, you can't put it in a point line or a polygon. It comes into a file called a geotiff, and that's, the data is stored in pixels. So it's good for showing either continuous or categorical data. So things like land cover, elevation is frequently stored as a raster file. And those are the two main kinds of data you'll probably use. So how is your data represented on a map? So different kinds of data are represented using different layers and different shapefiles. So like I said before, your points, lines, and polygons are going to be different, but also your shapefiles are each going to have different kinds of data. Like, let's say, like, you will have a shapefile, you'll have a layer that has only the population information, and then you'll have a layer that has elevation data, and then you'll have a layer that shows, you know, rivers and roads. And all these things will be in different layers, which you can turn on and off depending on the kind of map you want to make. Let's say your boss wants a map of, you know, major roads and rivers, but he also wants a map of population data. You wouldn't put both of those things on the map at once, but you would store them in separate layers so you can turn those on and off in your GIS and create two maps from it. Now, layers, they hold geometric location, spatial information like geometry and where it is on a globe, but it also has non-spatial information. So on the back end, let's say you're looking at a borough file of New York. On the back end, you can have the population for each borough. You can have tree coverage, number of hospitals, things like that. So this is the attribute table I was talking about when we're talking about the back end. So you have, on the left, you have the map, and it shows the shapefile on that bar on the left side. And the attribute table is on the right, so that's the back end data. And each column will represent a different kind of data. Every shapefile should have, every attribute table should have the X, Y data, like I said, like labels, population information for each point, line, or polygon. And you can also, within a GIS software, you can create new columns or data from those existing columns. Like if you want to normalize population by square mile, you can do that. So this is, I feel like this is kind of dry, but it's very important to know. A geographic coordinate system versus a projected coordinate system. So a geographic coordinate system, it describes where a location is on Earth. So the Earth is round, and so it's measured in angular units, usually degrees. But when you're making a map, you always want to take your data and put it into a projected coordinate system. So it's the geographic coordinate reference system that has been flattened. Think about the best analogy I can think of is think about if you have an orange, you know, an orange is round. But when you peel that orange, and if you flatten the peel, it's not round anymore, and it's not necessarily a rectangle. Depending on how you cut that orange peel, that'll determine what the peel looks like and what shape it is. So a projected coordinate system is basically how you're slicing the orange and putting it on a map. And we do this because you can't really measure point-to-point distance on a globe because it's not flattened. So when you flatten the map, you can do point-to-point distances. Okay, so I'll quickly go through the three major kinds of projections. So you have the conic projection. So this image just shows conceptually what that is. Think about like putting the cone on the map, and right where the cone touches, you would unfold that cone. And the way your map looks when it's unfolded is the projection. So since one of the drawbacks of this is since a cone is wider than it is tall, the map becomes a little more distorted as you move north or south of the point of contact, the standard parallel. So if you look at that image, you see it gets a little more the distances change a little as you go north or south of that standard parallel. Then you have a cylindrical projection. This is really commonly used for world maps. So just to conceptualize it, you'll see that cylinder around the globe, and at the point where it touches, you unfold. You're unfolding that cylinder, and the way it unfolds is how it's shown. And then the final projection is a planar projection. So this is common. This is one of the more common ones because it's used to highlight a specific area. At least for me, when I do presentations, it's not normally a global map. It's a very specific area. So think about it as taking a sheet and putting it tangent to the globe at a single point, and then taking what it touches and then flattening it out. So this is good for preserving distances, but the distortions change as you increase the size of the map and move away from that central point of contact. Okay, so these are some the main visual map elements. So the really important elements are, of course, the map, but you also need a legend, title, your data sources always, and labels. Some optional things, but recommended, are the north arrow and the scale bar. You'll see here, this is a map from the New Jersey Bike Ped Organization. So this is a land use map, and I saw this and thought it was really well labeled. All the colors are very clear and different. The legend is very clear. You have the scale bar on the bottom right, and you have the source at the bottom. So to me, like, everything is very clear. It's very well laid out. This to me is a really good example of a map you would use. So some quick best practices. Always normalize your data, and I can't stress this enough. I see most of the bad maps I've seen is because they're mapping raw counts, and raw counts don't really tell you much except population distribution. Because, for example, I work with car crashes. People might say, oh, like, there's a lot of car crashes in Midtown, but also that's where most cars go through. So it's not necessarily that Midtown, like, it's really just a reflection of the number of cars in Midtown rather than it being inherently dangerous. Label only the critical elements of your map. Overlabeling makes a map really hard to read. An example I like to use, I've seen a lot of maps where it's a close-up of a street grid and every single street is labeled. And that makes it a little chaotic to read, especially if it's not a map specifically about streets. Like, you have every street labeled, and then you have every building labeled. I suggest only labeling the really important parts. Think critically about your color palette. So some organizations have their own color palette and format, accounting for colorblindness, especially if you're doing a public presentation. And there are also sometimes there's industry standards. So for example, my background is city planning. So for land use, there are very specific colors you're supposed to use. So commercial is always red, residential land use is varying shades of yellow. So things like that to keep in mind your industry standards and what your company does. So organizing your shape files and documenting all analyses. So if you use GIS software, it's very easy to add new fields to the back end of your shapefile at attribute table. But when you're using dedicated GIS software, you're pointing and clicking and doing those calculations using the field calculator. So unlike when you use R, you don't have, you know, several lines of code to document what you did. You kind of have to remember. So always just documenting everything and keeping all your shapefiles in one place. And scale is super important. So I always like to have a scale bar to show what your map is covering. Because things might look close together, but if you've got a map where end to end it's 20 miles, the two points you're looking at might not be that close. So always have a scale bar if you can. So now we have all this data. We have points, lines, polygons, raster data. So what do we do? How can we visualize it? So I'm going to go through some maps and show you how you should not visualize this data. So I've seen this, for some reason this came up in my Twitter feed a lot. It's fun, but it's chaotic. Like, some these maps are cool, like when you're reading an article, like a BuzzFeed article or something, but this is like, it's extremely chaotic, it's hard to read, you don't know what to focus on. And if you want to see more terrible maps, that link at the bottom, I found this on the terrible map subreddit. So if you want beyond this, please check that out. At times, it's just a population. So obviously, this is not a real map, but this is. I see a lot of, especially maps that go viral, like maps that are in memes, I see a lot that are like really just population maps. Okay, so this map came up recently, and I knew I wanted to include it here. So this is from the New York City Department of Health. They were mapping COVID cases. And if you look at this map...
Ayanthi, just one second. I don't think... Oh, there we go. It hadn't updated. Okay, go ahead. Sorry.
Oh, not a problem. So I saw this map and was immediately surprised to see that Department of Health, they had mapped raw counts. And if you look at this, you might think, wow, Staten Island is this really big hotspot for COVID data. And I was like, okay, one, they're mapping raw counts, which is not great. And two, they're using zip codes. Never, ever use zip codes as your boundary. Zip codes are created by the post office for mail routes. So there's not really a spatial... There's not a spatial basis for them that is relevant to mapping. So I thought, okay, let me look at these. I want to put these zip code, overlay the zip codes with some other layers to show why zip codes are bad. So if you look next to the Department of Health map, that's a map that I quickly pulled together. And I wanted to overlay parks and open space with the zip codes. So if you look at that area of Staten Island, a lot of that is green space. So there's not a lot of people living there. And even on some of these other areas, like there's maps and bodies of water. So it's not always representative of what's actually there. Like a place might look bigger and small, or like a bigger or smaller case rate because there's fewer housing units there, or there are other factors that you haven't accounted for. And I wanted the next slide, I'm going to show a close up of some zip codes to show you how chaotic zip codes can be. Okay, so here's a close up of Midtown Manhattan, and unfortunately, I couldn't get the labels just right because. Just because the size of the labels, they were overlapping too much. I did the best I could. But each of those little polygons is a zip code. So especially in New York, there are some buildings that have their own zip code. So if you're mapping by a zip code, you're going to get a lot of zeros if, let's say, like I think one of these is the Chrysler building. So, I mean, if you're serving people from their homes, like that Chrysler building zip code is going to be zero. And a lot of these building footprints are going to be zero. So I wanted to zoom in on Midtown and the financial district to show like how these zip code boundaries don't always make the most sense for geospatial analysis. And you really just shouldn't use zip codes. So this is a COVID map from the New York Times. And they did, I want to say this was, I forget exactly when this was published. I want to say 2 or 3 weeks ago. And these, this is a, how Americans were traveling as lockdown started. So, you know, you might look at this map and think, oh, wow, like the South and Texas and the Midwest are just like, they're going about their day-to-day lives as usual. And New Yorkers and New Jerseyans are staying in place. When in reality, the South and Midwest are much more rural than New York. So they already travel much longer day-to-day. They have some longer commute times. So mapping it this way with out that kind of background information can be misleading. This is just bad. Two of those legend colors are the same. I mean, it's just like, this was chaotic. This came up in my Twitter feed and I just didn't know what to think. And the colors are just misleading, no end day. Like, does that mean indefinitely? What does that mean? And it's just, I don't know. This was just chaotic for me. So to finish it up, I wanted to point out some useful resources if you want to get your hands dirty with some GIS. There's this book, How to Lie with Maps by Mark Monmonier. I think this is a great introduction to maps. If you've never taken a GIS course in your life, it reads kind of like just like a regular book. I keep it at my desk at all times. Geographic Information Systems and Science, this is a dedicated textbook. When I was in grad school, we had a lot of readings from it, and a lot of my professors' presentations were based on it, so I recommend that. As far as organizations and companies, USGS, the United States Geological Survey, they collect a lot of GIS data, and they put out a lot of informational material. Esri is the maker of proprietary GIS software. I don't know how much a home license is. I know a professional one is like thousands of dollars a year. So you, unless you have it at your work, you probably won't be using it, but they do have a lot of good tutorials. QGIS is free open source GIS software. So I highly recommend using that if you want to play around making maps. And then finally, the New York City Open Data Portal has a lot of geospatial data sets to get you started with analyzing spatial data. The zip code maps I created, I pulled everything in there from the Open Data Portal. And that's it. If you want to see any of my passionate GIS tweets, you can follow me on Twitter at honeybadger88. And yeah, that's it.
That was awesome. Thank you so much, Ayanthi. Wow, that was great. So we have a lot of questions that are coming up in chat. So I'll just start at the top and we can sort of go through. And Angela started addressing a few of them. And so Angela, feel free to unmute yourself if you want to elaborate. I might ask some people if I can unmute them to elaborate on their question if it isn't all there. But let's just start at the top here. So let's see. From Alexa, what's the best method for normalizing data? Just dividing values by polygon area, and how would you do this in R? And Angela mentioned that normalizing data by population within a boundary is a good place to start. So for example, crimes per capita instead of raw crime counts. Ayanthi, do you have other suggestions to add to that?
For the normalizing data?
Yeah, within a boundary.
So yeah, the population is good. I think it depends on the data. So for example, when we look at car crashes, we don't normalize by land area. We normalize by the length of all the roads. So I think it really depends on the data you're looking at, like their street miles and land cover. So, you know, for population, I think you can normalize population by land area, but something like car crashes, or I'm trying to think of, there's a like a public garbage can data set on open data. So I think that might also be something I would normalize by street miles.
Oh, that's a great point. I like that.
And as far as how you would do it in R, Angela might get into this in her presentation, so I don't want to go too far into it, but there's a package called SF and you can pull in this data. So it kind of looks like a data table and you can do all those calculations in R. Dividing one column by another the same way you would with data tables.
Awesome. We have a lot of questions about zip codes. So from Sarah, any tips or pitfalls to watch out for in working with zip code data and Xacta shape files?
Hang on, sorry, zip code data and?
ZCTA shape files.
What is that?
These are census tracts.
Is that the zip? Hang on a second, you're frozen.
Am I back?
Zip code tabulation
areas?
Zip code tabulation areas. I would just not use zip codes at all if you can. I would try and, because I don't even think zip codes match well to census tracts, right? Because the post office creates zip codes. So I would use census tracts if you can. Also for New York, there are NTAs, which are based off of census tracts. So NTA stands for Neighborhood Tabulation Area. And the shapefile for that is on open data, is on New York City open data. So I would highly suggest using either census tracts or NTAs instead of zip codes.
Excellent. Okay. So Angeline, I think that might have answered your question about other potential geographic boundaries you can use. But in general, I'll ask this question. So for data collection, when other small geographic boundaries like community district might not be well known by the people being surveyed and they don't feel comfortable giving the address, what would be an alternative?
Hang on. So the alternative for giving, like, if you're surveying someone.
Right. Here, Angeline, do you mind if I unmute you and you can elaborate?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I guess the idea is that if you're trying to plot information, like survey information, but when you ask people, like if you wanted to, if you wanted to plot survey information and you ask people for information so that you can plot it, like it, people may not be comfortable giving their address. They may not know what their NTA is. So do you have like other suggestions for plotting like in those cases?
Huh, that's a tough one because my instinct is to say neighborhood because that's what NTAs are based on. But some neighborhoods are really big. Like if you say I live in Midtown East, like that could be anywhere. One thing that just popped into my head, I wonder if syncing like what's the nearest subway station to you? Because that is a little more granular. But it's kind of hard to ask if you are asking someone for a location without, like, unless you put, like, a map of the NTAs on there and say, like, which of these neighborhoods do you live in?
Great. There's also a we'll do one more question, and then if there's time at the end for more, we can tackle them there. So Sarah asks, where do non-ZCTA polygons come from? I've seen them on New York City open data, but I wasn't clear what the source may be.
So I think there's a mix. I think, so Department of City Planning puts together some of these. Like, I think they're in charge of putting together the NTAs. The neighborhood tabulation areas. Like I know the street file is maintained by Department of Transportation. I know this because that's part of what I do, but it's a joint effort between DOT and city planning. Do It actually maintains a lot of the polygons. Do It of information also maintains a lot of the open space and playground and park data sets.
Awesome. Ayanthi, you broke up right at the end there. Would you mind just writing in chat the name of the source that has some of that information?
Yeah. So
awesome. That was fantastic. Well, big round of applause for Ayanthi. I know everybody else is muted, but that was really great. I know I learned a lot. So I'm gonna turn over to Angela Lee, who, Angela, if you can share your screen, feel free to take over that.
For sure. I think Ayanthi, you might need to stop sharing.
Oh, whoops. There we go.
All right, I think my talk fits pretty well with yours actually, because you covered some of the basics that I didn't touch on too much. So really excited to be here today. So thank you for having me, Emily.
We're thrilled to have you. Oh, and I didn't do your little intro, Angela, which I can
do. Oh, okay, quickly. Feels free. Yeah, go ahead.
She's a researcher and our spatial advocate at the Center for Spatial Data Science at the University of Chicago. And she is involved with the Our Lady Chicago chapter. And so we're thrilled to have her with us remotely. That's kind of the fun benefit of the situation.
Great. Thanks so much, Emily. I think Emily and I were talking about some other schemes for Our Ladies and Our Forwards. And Emily asked me to do this. So very excited to be here and actually bounce off some ideas that I've been pondering for a while. So the inspiration for this talk is actually twofold. So hopefully that works. Background for this talk is Mayal Salmon, who is a really cool R lady in Europe, gave a talk last year called How to Be a Resilient R User. And if you haven't seen the slides for this, I would highly recommend checking it out because a lot of it is about metaprogramming and sort of the skills around learning to code and learning to work with spatial data or any type of data that basically helps you learn faster and develop your skills. So I read the slides for this. I didn't actually see it in person, but I thought it was a really good way to think about, you know, how do you ask for help or how do you find information that can help you in the long run? So that was sort of rumbling in the back of my head. I've also given a talk for DCR, so the DCR conference, about the care and feeding of spatial data. And this is sort of informed by some of the work that I do at the University of Chicago, working with researchers and troubleshooting a lot of their spatial data questions. And then sort of the thing that provoked me to give this talk at all is the launch of the hashtag OurSpatialChat, which is basically a sort of help desk that I run weekly for people to ask questions about spatial things with R specifically. So recommend all of these things, but the sort of framework of this talk is giving some skills beyond, I'm gonna talk about some pitfalls and maybe some things that I've encountered, but also jumping into sort of what can you do to advance your sort of skill building and all of that good stuff. By the way, the link to these slides are at the bottom of all of the slides, so you can feel free to pull those up and follow along. So I think I'm going to frame this in sort of a learning journey type of way. So we're going to talk about getting started, learning more, and then plugging into the RSpatial, maybe RSpatial Ladies community. And so this is sort of how I've seen myself evolve as a spatial data scientist. So my background is originally in economics. So before I did a lot of econometrics and things, and it was only after sort of working on a problem that was explicitly spatial that I started getting really into spatial data. So I'm a social scientist by training, and spatial data has been, I've been working heavily with it for around 4 years. This was sort of in the process of like an academic journey. So I have gone through this step, these three steps myself. A little bit more about me, I guess, since I haven't met some of you coming from Chicago. I'm a research specialist / RSpatial advocate at the Center for Spatial Data Science. I lead weekly workshops for our center for researchers, teaching them spatial methods, spatial statistics, and when they sort of move past some of the beginner stuff, a little bit of spatial econometrics as well. I do some of my own research. So right now, I think previously I did some work on housing and looking sort of more on that. Right now I'm on the public health side, so not focusing on COVID right now. We have a different team doing that, but looking at the opioid epidemic and access to treatment there. I also co-organize Our Lady Chicago, so we have an awesome team of women and gender minorities on our group. So we started in July 2017. It's just been a great time. So come out to Chicago, visit us. We'd love to see you once all this goes, like everything goes back to normal, maybe. I'm also a carpentries instructor. So if anyone is interested in this initiative, it's basically teaching researchers, academic researchers, how to teach computational skills. So I'm part of this sort of consortium of teaching and learning. And highly recommend you go through and get certified. I've learned a lot about how to teach things like R, and it's been really, really helpful, especially if you are in an academic setting where you're trying to, you know, encourage people around you to use the same software as you, try to get them to use reproducible things. And a few other things. I'm co-organizing Stat Art Day Chicago. So we're doing a virtual conference featuring Chicagoland users. Use ours in a week. So registration is still open. You all can feel free to join. We'd love to have you. And then the bottom photo, I think there are actually some New York R ladies in there, maybe one or two. This was a workshop that we put on for R forwards. So teaching folks how to develop packages and put them on GitHub. I think so, I see some things in the chat and I can't actually see any of it when I'm sharing my screen. Oh, there we go. Yay. Okay. Awesome. So I guess I just wanted to but my Wi-Fi connection is not being very resilient. So here we are. I think I don't know what a good way to troubleshoot this is. I'm happy to call in instead and have someone advance my slides. If this happens again, maybe that makes sense.
That would be fine. Yeah. Do you want to, do I have the link to them?
Yeah, I'll send them to you right now. Do a few other things in the art community. Okay, so I guess this talk is pitched at, maybe you have some background in other types of statistical modeling, you've used R for other things, but maybe you haven't really worked with geospatial data in R specifically. Sort of the question that you're asking is, how do you go from, you know, this, you know, CSV or spreadsheet of like borough numbers and like all this data attached to it with like prices, and how do you go from that to something like, you know, an interactive map with like, you know, analyses and clustering? I think I pulled this from Two Sigma's like dashboard or something that they put on the Shiny contest. So how do you go from, you know, your raw data to something like this? And I think when people hear spatial data science, they think a lot, you know, like I'm just standing there, like making all these dashboards, thinking really critically, like, you know, looking at these fun animations with like a group of really intense other people. And I think the real deal of spatial data science is, I have spent a lot of time the last 2 years just sitting with researchers and like installing packages and troubleshooting like installs and trying to figure out what's going on and how to get this like, you know, to get the analyses that they need for their research. And so over the last 2 years, I think there are certain questions that I get asked a lot. And those questions are, where can I get spatial data? Like, what even is spatial data? You know, what is a coordinate reference system? You know, what are projections? And I think you covered it really well, so I'm just gonna gloss over that section. You know, what R packages should I use? Like, I search for spatial data tutorials and I see like tens of okay, I think I want to call in so Emily can share my slides, and then hopefully this will go a little bit more smoothly. I'll try to do it from my phone, so I'm not on a Wi-Fi connection. This usually hasn't happened. Thank you.
It's okay. So it goes. You are in common questions, right?
Yeah. And I don't know if it's easier for me to call in from my phone, and I guess I can just have that. I'm so sorry, folks. Should have tested out this tech. Cool. So I'm just going to go with this. Zoom is showing some performance problems right now. Oh, yikes. Okay. You know, I need help on X. So next slide. Great. So starting with the first question, where can I get spatial data? This is actually something that struck me.
Sorry.
Yeah, perfect. Perfect. The first time I taught a spatial econometrics workshop, and then I was like so excited about my modeling. I was so excited about showing these methods. And at the end of the entire workshop, one of the attendees raises their hand and they're like, so like, where do I get any economic data? Like, how do I find that like data? Like, where do I get geospatial data? And I'm like, oh no, like I've given you all of these tools and techniques for doing this, and you don't have, you know, the geospatial data that you need to get started with this. I think a common misperception among folks is that certain things are geospatial data when they're not actually. So next slide. So what I will often see actually when I'm working with folks is that they'll have an Excel spreadsheet. They'll be like, oh, I have all the geographic locations of the emergency departments in Illinois. I'm really excited to like do some analysis on this, look at, you know, how close people are to their nearest emergency department. And when I bring in their Excel sheet and look at the data, what I see is, I see they have the hospital, they have the location, which they count as a geographic piece, and then they have the region. And so if I look at the next, if I look at this really carefully, two things strike me. The geographic data that they have is not really geographic data, right? So if I'm looking at the last two columns, I only see the location and region, right? So this is not useful to me as a spatial data scientist because I can't, you know, do geographic operations on this. And so basically I now need to stop, pause, and tell the researcher, you need to geocode your data. So what does that mean? You basically need to transform it from like location, like it's in Rockford, Illinois, to like latitude and longitude. Or you need to join it to a spatial boundary file. Like you need to attach it to something that is geographic in nature, like a shape file. So you can do this by ID. You can do it like, you know, if something has like a, you know, a zip code attached to it, and you have, as we said, we're not supposed to use zip codes, but sometimes this is what people have. Like maybe you can do that. I think the best way to go is geocode it, change it to latitude and longitude, and then intersect it with, you know, there with the geography, which is known as a spatial join. So this is something that, you know, people are like, what? Like, you know, Rockford, Illinois is not like geographic. Like I can't just plot that. And I have to tell them, nope, like you need latitude and longitude and you need to project it. And they're like, their minds are blown. Like they didn't realize this is an intermediate step they needed to take. And so ideally the data would be geocoded and it would look like the next piece. And it would look like, it would have these two columns for latitude and longitude, right? So geocoding is sort of a fancy process, basically just taking the addresses, sticking like points onto them, and then you can use them to plot with and things like that. I will say, you can see the last column is a match score. So when you do geocode like things like addresses, there are, you know, certain things are really quickly geocoded, like they're accurate, but once you have something that's like around 84 or 85, like you might want to start checking that data to make sure it's in the right place. So choosing your own geocoding adventure, next slide. You can, you know, batch geocode, you can talk to, if you're in academia like I am, you can talk to your GIS librarian and they can just set something up for you. You might have to pay money for an ArcGIS license or some sort of geocoding service. This is where people get stuck and they're like, oh no, like I have to like go out of R, or I have to do something else. And this is unfortunate sometimes. There are some R package alternatives. There are rate limits on their use. I think it's like 2,000 a day. So you could use the OpenStreetMap geocoder, which is a free open source tool that is basically a map generated. It's like a Wikipedia map. Like everyone, it's like a wiki map. Everyone can just put stuff on it and it's checked by people daily. Or you could use ggmap geocode, which I think uses Google Maps, or OpenCage. So that's a common issue. Other times you might, you know, have different types of data. So other sources of spatial data, next slide, are, you know, I just talked about, I think two, which is inherited data with spatial features. Sometimes I just get inherited like CSVs with latitude and longitude. You know, open data portals are awesome. Sometimes people just, you know, hand me the random shape files they find on the internet. There are, you know, ideally we would have like our spatial data packages, like Tidy Census is amazing. I love it so much and highly recommend. And I'll talk a little bit about a package that I wrote for teaching with spatial data in it. Okay, so the next question that I get a lot, what is a coordinate reference system? And for that, next slide. Oh, go ahead, go up. It's yep. So I'll just not talk about them at all. Don't worry about it, you'll be fine. This is something that trips people up a lot. As Ayanthi says, this is something that you'll be importing your data. This is sort of the strings as factors of the geospatial world, right? So like, you're like trying to do things and it's not quite working and you just don't know why it's not working. And so just like a few graphics about what a projection is. As Ayanthi said, like there are a few common ones. So, you know, like there's a conic projection, there's sort of the Mercator, there's like more azimuthal
But basically, you're just going from 3D to 2D, and there are various ways of doing that, and that might lead to problems if you have two different projections on two different things that you're trying to join together. So for example, the US, you can, if you look at the next slide, you can have multiple ways of projecting it. So Mercator, you know, a good sign of if you're using the Mercator is that the line at the top of the US is totally flat. You know that someone is a pro with like GIS if you see a map of the US and the top is curved, right? So then you're like, someone has actually thought about like projecting this. This is awesome. So I always get excited when I see that the top of the US is curved, if you're working with US-wide data. Because like that is like a little bit better in terms of like accurate shape, you know, representation. So, you know, these are various ways. When you start working with geospatial data, you're going to get this really weird error. And if you're working with the SF package, it looks a little bit like the following. You'll get an error that says STCRS of A is not equal to the STCRS of B. And no one knows what this means. You know, this is not very verbose. What it essentially means is the following image, or that image right there, which is your two things are not aligned, so we can't put them together. Right, so like the way something is projected is not the same as something else. So you need to make sure that they're in the same projection so that you can plot things together. This has tripped up like almost everyone I know, and so many times it like trips me up every once in a while too. So that's just something to be aware of. So to fix that in the SF package, you would just the next thing you would do is ST transform of B to the coordinate reference system of A. And just imagine that these two are aligned. I didn't have the time to sort of put them aligned together, but imagine that they're aligned. So just like one image, right? Okay, so third question I get, which is sort of specific to R, there are so many packages that you could be using for spatial data, right? So, you know, which ones do I use? You know, sort of the tongue-in-cheek thing to say is, you know, go to the CRAN task view, which I don't know if you've ever done this, but if you go to like cran.r-project.org/web/view/spatial, there's essentially like a write-up of every single spatial package that was ever produced by any, like not everyone, but like as many of the most important ones as you can find. So this is like actually sort of interesting. Like I think they rewrote it recently and it's a lot more readable. However, you may not wish to read an entire, like, you know, 4,000 word web page about which spatial package you should be using, and it might not be relevant to what you're doing. So I'm going to give you a few places to start. So the ones that I highly recommend are using the R packages in this book. So Geocomputation with R is an amazing resource. Highly recommend if you're, like, trying to learn GIS. I think in the chat, geocoding services, like figuring out which ones. Cool. So I highly recommend Geocomputation with R as like a sort of comprehensive introduction to GIS in R specifically. So if you want to just like read it, like feel free. However, I think the packages, this book came out last year and the packages in it are pretty up to date. If you're starting in 2020 to learn spatial data, I would highly recommend these packages. You'll find a lot of other things online with using SP, RGDAL, RGeos, like GGSpatial, other things. To save yourself pain in your workflow going forward, I would recommend trying SF. TMAP is awesome. I think it can be twiddly, so you might just use SF and ggplot2. Raster is like the package for raster data, obviously. And then I think in their package, they have some sample data called SP data, which is, yeah, yay, I love this assertion that SF is much, much better than RGDAL. Yeah, it's sort of a lot more feature rich and the function API is a lot better. Beyond this set of packages, in terms of quick start packages, I would also take a look at, you know, Tidy Census is awesome if you're in the US. GGMap, I know, I don't use it that much because I don't need base maps that much. But if you want like a Google base map, like it's a good one to get that. And then Leaflet is sort of underpinning a lot of the interactive our like interactive mapping packages. It can be a little bit twiddly, but it works really, really well with Shiny because they're by the same people. So there are many, many specialized packages, which I'm not going to go into today. I use others for point pattern modeling, spatial regression and other things, but I think they're not as relevant to everyone. So, what else do you use? Feel free to throw something into the chat if you have questions. So once you've decided to embark on this path of installing your packages and whatnot, what you will run into is the following. Everyone knows 80% of data science is cleaning data. What they don't tell you is that with geospatial data science, 80% is installing stuff. I think if your version of R is up to date, this will not be a huge problem. However, a lot of the geospatial libraries depend on things outside of R, C++ libraries, to make them go. And so this is the library that is especially used is one called GDEL, which allows you to read basically almost any geographic file format possible. SF is connected to this. And so under the hood, SF is sort of a wrapper to GDEL. It means that you can read all sorts of weird, wonky file paths file paths like map info and like weird things like that. It also means that there are certain things that you need to get right when installing. I think they fixed this in the newer versions of SF, but if you do get a lot of errors, know that it's not you, it's the spatial library dependency. It's not you. Spatial library dependency. So something I've told people I've worked with, you are not a bad person because you're getting error messages. You're fine. It's just the dependency. So your worth is not tied to your error messages, right? Okay, so a little bit of a plug of three packages that I think are cool that not that many people know about now. I think it seems like a lot of people know about SF here. Highly recommend using the SF package. You'll do library SF, stread, ers.shp. Or read SF, ers.hp if you prefer tibbles, you'll get a nice tidy SF data frame. So what that looks like is sort of the simple feature collection with 65 features and 5 fields. So it just looks like a normal data frame. But the last column, if you look at the right, has a geometry in it. And so it has a point there, you'll see that that's a little bit different in the header. But this is really nice because it means it works with things like dplyr, it works with data frame first workflows. I'm also a fan of tmap. Just this cool graphic I made. So you can go from static to interactive with one command. So this is actually really, really cool because you just need to change the tmap mode to view instead of plot. And I was looking at the squirrel count, and I know we're not supposed to do counts, but it should be a rate. But I guess this is sort of the squirrel population by area of Central Park. So I think I discovered from looking at this, which was a Tidy Tuesday challenge a few weeks ago, is that they're the most squirrels in the Ramble, which is, I think, the woodsy area in the middle of Central Park, which makes sense. So there are 250 to 300 squirrels there. So pretty fun data set. If you haven't played with it, it's a good one to play with in terms of spatial data. I basically got, as I said, I got the point locations for the squirrels from the data set, and then I joined it to a boundary of the parts. And I spatial joined it to something that broke down the parts of Central Park into areas. Yeah, so ultimately, I think what makes TMAP good is that you can alternate between interactive exploration and static mapping. So that's sort of my takeaway there. I guess next is MapView. So if you love GIS, this actually might be something that you want to check out. So it sort of offers this pop-up box, and you can toggle the background and maps. And it's one line of code, so it might be worth taking a look at. So you can see the feature attributes provided with a pop-up query, and then mouse over things. So it's pretty fun. Okay, so I think I've sort of gone through three of the most asked questions in my
helping people out. Sort of from there on out, I'm like, go learn things. And people are like, wait, what resources can I use to learn more? And it turns out the best piece of knowledge I gave someone one day was the following, which was how to Google search for spatial data. I think this was something that I didn't know, like sort of the, having the right terminology to describe what you're looking for is often the most important thing, right? So you're like trying to phrase your like data request in a way that actually gets you the thing that you want. So what you're gonna do is use words like park district boundaries, food vendor shapefile, administrative district polygons, road network geometries, like abandoned car GIS file. And so those are the words that are gonna get you the spatial data that you need. Instead of saying like, you know, park district outline. I think like there are better ways to sort of ask for the spatial data. And so you're looking for like .shp files, right? If I search NYC boundary shapefile geospatial.shp.geojson just to make things a little bit safe, to make sure I get everything, I get the following, which is, you know, borough boundaries, NYC open data, NYC gov. And this is the key of all coding. It's essential remembering what to Google. So there's our secret. So in terms of more resources, I highly recommend staying informed if you're on, yes. And then, yes, state and government agencies like open data portals, like they have things that are in awesome formats. So staying informed, so making sure that you're using, you know, modern tools, like you're not like you're keeping up to date with like the tutorials being produced. There's a hashtag called rspatial, which is different from rstats. So some of you may have used rstats before. If you're looking for spatial specifically, the rspatial hashtag is run mainly by a contingent of European dudes, but also me. So like I'm also there. I also am aware. And if you're interested in sort of a more discussion-based, like definitely like you'll get an answer from someone friendly. I do a weekly rspatial chat, hashtag Tuesdays 10 to noon CST. I directly answer questions, and then I like slowly monitor them over the week. And then there's also this site called r-spatial.org, which has some sort of blog posts. So in the rspatial chat recently, my friend Shell, who I think is in Africa, she asked, hey, I want to learn how to create amazing ggplot2 graphs using shapefile data. Are there materials that are well documented that I can use? Whatever I found online was not very detailed. And I was like, oh yeah, like there's a 3-part series on ggplot2 and SF, which actually highly recommend these. It's on the rspatial site. If someone can find the link, feel free to throw it in the chat. And I like linked her to all of those. And it really walks you through like how to do SF and ggplot mapping. And I'll direct you to that instead of teaching you myself because it's all there. I think something else, to think about as you're working on geospatial data is to get inspired. So you can be doing your analyses, but sometimes you just wanna do something fun. I highly recommend taking a look at the 30-day map challenge. So that's really fun on Twitter. You see all these beautiful illustrations. I think someone named Bob Rudis, who you might, some of you might know as I think HRBRMSTR on Twitter. I think it stands for Harbor Master, has like a book down of all the maps that he made and all the R code that he used to make it. That map on the right was made in ggplot2. So you can do things like that. Try to replicate analyses and maps from others. Play around with visualization. Keep in mind like some cartography rules, right? Like plot rates, not counts. See if you can make something similar or replicate stuff. So it doesn't have to be super serious. You know, you could be like mapping squirrels in Central Park, right? So highly recommend that as a way to build your skills. Nice. Cool. So common questions I get, I need help on X, and we're reaching the end. I'm almost done, I promise. And this is actually something that I pulled from Mayal's talk, which is sort of the following rule of thumb. So try first by yourself for 30 minutes, right? You're going to spend 30 minutes on any coding problem that you have. You're going to say, I'm going to try to figure this out. Make a reasonable effort to solve the problem. So like read the docs. I will say the spatial docs are really hard to read. So that might not be the best place to start. I would like, you know, use the search engine, experiment, tootle around with it. And then this is a rule of thumb. Ask questions after that. You know, ask your colleagues, ask our ladies like Ayanthi or me. There is a R Spatial and an R Help channel on the Our Ladies community Slack that you can ask in that is safe. So it's not, you know, it's not public. So feel free to throw something in there and we'll try to take a look and answer it. But you could also ask questions publicly. So this is a little bit more scary because it sort of involves, you know, putting your question out there and seeing what people will say. You can use the R Spatial hashtag. You can use the weekly R Spatial chat hashtag. You can use GIS Slack Stack Overflow, and you can use the RStudio community site, among other things. So also recommend sharing your knowledge. So there's a weekly RSpatial chat hashtag.
Just one moment, we'll get Angela back.
This should be titled How to Not Have a Resilient Internet Connection while talking about resilient data science. Anyway.
Oh, great.
All right. Where did I cut out? Talking about sharing knowledge.
Yep.
All right. Cool. So I think the thing to keep in mind is for a lot of the spatial stuff in R is that most people don't have that much background. There's not very much documentation out there and not that many people are writing blog posts. So you could see on the right that this is a, oh, awesome. Erin says you might make a RSpatial channel on your Slack. Yay, I'll be in there too. Cool, so on the right, there's this is a blog post called, I think it's like How to Make an Animated Map with GG Animate. And this like was written by an R lady named Daniela. You can find it online. It's pretty awesome. And you can, you know, because she wrote it like 3 years ago, I think it's like one of her top, you know, accessed tutorials, and you can go and take a look at it. So I want to tell a little story to end this whole thing about our spatial chat. This really started with me sharing my knowledge. So an RStats friend, Wei Yang, tagged me in a post. RStats spatial nerds, do you have a go-to package or tool for converting lat long to some geographic unit, zip code, city, state, county? He tagged me in it, and like the good spatial data advocate I am, I realized I knew the answer in under 240 characters, and I felt like answering it. So I said, oh, use tidy census in SF, you know, do the following, pull the geographic units using tidy census, then spatial join it, and then get the geographic units it falls in. So I was like, yes, I can do this. You know, this was like a quick, easy win. And so you know, people were really excited about this, like retweeted it. And then people started asking me more questions after this, or saying like, no, I do it this way. And I'm like, oh yeah, like great. And so one person was like, you can do it in Stata, like in Geo and Poly. Like, he's like, is there a cheat sheet for this type of thing? And I'm like, oh, I know where the cheat sheet is. I've used that cheat sheet, right? And so I like linked the cheat sheet and gave it to that person. And then like someone asked about like geocoding, like, how do I do that? And I'm like, oh, like, I think they said like something about the open cage package. And I'm like, yes, like that's a great package. And I gave them the link. So I still had more free time. someone asked like, oh, like you mean like I do this thing, you know, I use SP over, I convert coordinates to spatial points. I do over this way. And I'm like, yes, this is a valid way to do it. Just because you use different code doesn't mean that you can't get to the same result, right? So this is sort of a way that was developed before SF. I think if you were using spatial before it was developed, this is a really effective way to do the same thing. It's a workflow that many people use rather than the sort of tidy version that I use. And then someone else asked, you know, wow, damn, this thread is going to get me out of ArcGIS so fast. So I was like, yes, converts to RSpatial. And then I like gave them the link to the ggplot2 tutorials. I was like, yes. So that was exciting. All of this to say that my day of rapid tweeting led to me sort of launching a project, which is RSpatial chat. So oops, started a new project. So I said, I had a lot of fun reading research responses, learning and sharing tips about spatial data in R in this thread. I'd love to leave a regular weekly RSpatial discussion. So I decided, you know, I'm pretty free Tuesday mornings because my usual workshop that was in person is no longer in person for obvious reasons. So I decided to make that my time that I would support the community, not in person, but with my virtual presence. So replacing sort of that in-person interaction with, you know, some virtual support. This was also good, by the way, because it saying that I would do it from 9 to 11 gave me a bounded volunteer time, and setting boundaries is always so important when you're, you know, giving your time to someone else. So we have office hours, we have boundaries, we love it. I think one thing to note is that all the people who asked me questions, almost, I think like 90% of them were men, and I was like, we need more RSpatial ladies. So that got my brain thinking a little bit too. And I've noticed this to be true for a long time, is that a lot of the package developers, a lot of the people who are vocal, a lot of the people who like consider themselves RSpatial people tend to be not R ladies. Like they tend to be a certain demographic, and that is dudes, which is totally fine. But I was like, we need more R ladies on this. And there actually are a number of R ladies working in spatial, right? But we don't really talk about it. So in progress with R ladies global, this is like the third project, because I'm just one for projects. We're thinking about setting up a working group for R spatial within R ladies. So the goal might be to teach a few spatial workshops to the larger spatial community within the next year. We're sort of still in the early processes of talking about this, but let me know if you're interested in helping or joining Slack. We have like a little Slack for the RSpatial ladies organizing. Yes, the people are excited. So we'll see where this goes, but I think one thing to do is probably tap into the community of people who use like GUIs and, you know, ArcGIS and QGIS, and have them start realizing the power of R. So finally, I think this community is a support for a lot of awesome things. So just earlier this week at this week's RSpatial chat, it's been a month in and like lots of stuff has come out of it. But I asked a question, you know, I tried to do my learning. Oh, go ahead. Go up. I try to do my learning in public. So, which is a scary thing to do too. So not saying that you need to do it. And I think for minorities and women, it is often, there's a reason that sometimes we don't do our learning in public, because people underestimate us, or, you know, like there is sort of a socialization of people to sort of underestimate us when we do our learning in public. Anyway, sort of an aside about society. I said, for me, I'm wrapping up work on a spatial data package and finally submitting it to CRAN. I feel like there aren't good practices for writing spatial data packages document. There are not. Spatial data can be large, so should you include raw data? Does anyone have best practices for this? And like, after I said this, like three people who I thought were amazing package developers said, hey, like, I don't really know what I'm doing either, but I tried this one thing. And then someone else said, oh, that's a good idea. Like, I did this other thing. And it really, really helped me realize that like other people are figuring it out too. And so I'm really, really excited to say that I did my first submission to CRAN this week. It's this like super basic spatial data package. It has like 7 data sets in it. Like, it is not all the data that should be in there. But I submitted it. We'll see what happens. It's not accepted yet, but it got out there. I was so inspired by this like conversation and seeing people being vulnerable and stuff, that I was like, okay, like if they can say this, like they don't really know what they're doing and they submitted the package anyway, like I could do it too, right? So I did that. It's like a really, really basic, very not that complicated data set. So, but I was excited. I went through the process, and that's my success of the week. And also like, I was like, I'm talking at R Ladies New York this week. I have to like have something to, you know, be proud of. So that's going to be it. So I think that's it for me in terms of talking about the community.
If you want to stay in touch, shameless plug no more, you can find me on Twitter. You can also reach out to me at ourladies.org, Angela at ourladies.org, angela-lee.github.io, Civic Angela on Twitter. And then this is the exciting announcement beyond all that exciting stuff. I may be in the tri-state area very soon, so I might be moving closer to New York and away from Chicago within the next probably like 3 months. So I hope to see a lot of you in person when we're able to do that. But I would love to meet some of you and get coffee once I'm moving over there. Ah, crazy. So I'll be in New Jersey, so not directly in New York. Probably a good thing for now. but hoping to get to pick your minds and really engage a little bit more in book club and all the things. Yeah, I know Chicago will be very sad to lose me, but we have an amazing group of organizers that are taking the lead here. So, hey, I'm not going to say anything about that claim in the chat, but I think that's it for me. Thank you for bearing with the technical difficulties.
Oh, Angela, this was fantastic. Thank you so much for joining us. And I just have to say, I mean, you know this, but I am just so impressed by you and all of the things that you do for our community are just amazing. So that was an amazing talk. I learned tons. I think you and Ayanthi, your talks just were so perfectly complimentary. And so I sort of lost touch. I have like 5 different things open that I'm trying to monitor here across all the different participants and chats and things. So I didn't catch any questions there, but if you have any, please raise your hand and I'll just unmute you and we can do it that way. And if any of the other hosts saw a question in the chat that I'm missing, please feel free to bump it up. So there is a question about how to do a spatial join.
Sure. Yeah. There's a function in SF called st_join. So I think the order that you want to do it is you want to make sure that your objects are in the same projection. So they're aligned. And then I think, Ayanthi, correct me if I'm wrong, is it points and then polygon or polygon and then points? I like can never remember. It's in the documentation as the very last thing. So I would like library SF and then like
I always mess this up.
Yeah, I have to look at it every time.
I Google it every time.
Yeah, is it this or is it this? The order does in fact matter depending on which one you want. So this is something that I feel like needs to be clarified, but it's in the very bottom of the documentation, I believe. So if you do *st_join* and scroll all the way to the bottom of the documentation and read the last line, I think it says which order it should be in.
Great. And we have another question. Any resources, example data sets for doing spatial mapping and analysis inside buildings? That's right. And Mara, you had a question earlier about that. So essentially she, I think, was thinking about how people move through a hospital, for example.
Right. I think for that you might... This is actually something that is a real problem for us when we're doing analyses of people living in apartment buildings, because all of your points are stacked on top of each other. So you have basically like this extremely high point density at this one location, right? Because, you know, you have like 1,000 people, maybe not, you know, like a huge number of people living in an apartment building. So for that, like it's actually like a spatial analysis problem. In terms of looking at movement within buildings, I think I would like, that seems like me, seems to me it's like a GPS like tracking sort of thing. Like you would want like traces from like someone's phone or someone like a device if you could get that and then work with that type of data to sort of look at patterns there. So like I think you would first need to think about how you're gonna collect that data and like what you're gonna use it for. And that's sort of like a hardware problem that I don't know that much about. So Ayanthi, I don't know if you have perspective on this.
So that's not something I've ever tried to do, but, and I wish I remembered like the name of the website, but I know there's one woman who has been working to map the inside of a lot of the New York City subways. But I'm like totally blanking on the name. Like maybe if you Google like NYC subway inside, like mapping inside, I don't know. I'm not even sure what to Google, but I know there's someone who has at least been trying to do that.
I actually have a follow-up question to that then. So, you know those maps where when you have those really high point densities, they become 3D with those spikes? Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Is there sort of an intuitive way to interpret that or best practices for mapping those so that it's not just, pretty looking versus interpretable?
Yeah, I mean, I feel like those maps, for me at least, Angela can maybe speak to a little more than me, but I find them, like, cool looking, but if you were showing it in, like, a meeting or something, they're not always terribly useful. Like, I just prefer using Coral Plus maps and, like, densities at various geographies to the 3D, because I find it a little cacophonous to see, like, basically these skyscrapers of data.
We have a couple more questions. Is usual work with all the setup and predictive models context or data viz solve more?
Angela might know this better than me.
So I think I'm not sure if I'm interpreting this question correctly, but like, can you do prediction or can you do machine learning with like spatial stuff? And I think the answer is yes. I would caution against something that we are not fan of is including just like latitude and longitude as a feature in a model. Like that's just like not good practice. I think people do use it, but there's better ways of sort of doing spatial modeling than just throwing it in a machine learning model. And for that is,
oh, she froze. Oh no, we lost her mid-sentence.
So sorry. this did not happen last week when I talked to Our Lady of Chicago. So maybe it's just that you are a fraud. I don't know. I think sort of on the modeling question is that there are very specific ways that are designed to model spatial sort of relationships in a way that is true to how spatial things actually work. So it's like networks. You affect the person in your network and the person in your network can affect you. And that's sort of a hard thing to grasp when you're working with like sort of traditional linear models or more sort of one directional stuff. If you're curious about this, you can learn about like spatial weights and all these like matrices and stuff like that. I think it's something that we focus on a lot at my center, but may not be totally relevant for your use case. So yeah, and this is also specifically talking about social science aerial data, like has boundaries, has like units. In terms of raster data, like it's like a totally different. And Emily, I think you know it's like a totally different ball game in terms of like the stats that you run on that stuff.
Indeed. Awesome. Okay, I think we got to the end of the questions and it's exactly 8:30, which is like the most perfect timing ever. So just again, a huge thank you to our two speakers, Ayanthi and Angela. This was such an informative and fantastic meetup tonight. And we had some really great participation. So thank you as well to our audience. And we're looking forward to seeing you all again soon. So keep an eye out. We'll announce more meetups coming up in the near future. And we look forward to seeing you then.